Good morning. Would you stand and make one another welcome in this house of the Lord? You can greet everybody on the way.
We're going to now do the call to worship. Please stand as you are able. When we stand at the edge of fear and worry,
God invites us to step into the waters of faith and trust.
When we stand at the edge of the world's pain and need,
Jesus invites us to step into the land of humble service.
When we stand at the edge of yearning for God, the Spirit invites us to enter this holy place of love and grace. The hymn of praise is remain standing for the opening prayer. Loving God, when we feel crushed by our worries, please lift our minds and help us to see your truth. When fear grips us tight, please free our hearts and help us to take things one step at a time. When we can't express the turmoil inside, please calm us with your quiet words of love. Help us to remember that you are with us, that you understand, and that you are safe in your love, held by your grace and freed by your truth. We pray with heart and mind and strength. Amen.
Thank you.
The reading today is from the New English Version, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack nothing. He lets me rest in grassy meadows. He leads me to restful waters. He keeps me alive. He guides me in proper paths for the sake of his good name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no danger because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they protect me. You set a table for me right in front of my enemies. You bathe my head in oil. My cup is so filled, it spills over. Yes, goodness and faithful love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the Lord's house forever. The New Testament reading is Matthew 6:25 through 34. Therefore I say to you, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll wear. Isn't life more than food and body more than clothes? Look at the birds in the sky. They don't sow seed or harvest grain or gather crops into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth much more than they are? Who among you, by worrying, can add a single moment to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? Notice how the lilies in the field grow. They don't wear themselves out with work, and they don't spin cloth. But I say to you that even Solomon in all of his splendor wasn't dressed like one of these. If God dresses grass in the field so beautifully, even though it's alive today and tomorrow it's thrown into the furnace, won't God do so much more for you, you people of weak faith? Therefore, don't worry and say, what are we going to eat? Or what are we going to drink? Or what are we going to wear? Gentiles long for all these things. Your heavenly Father knows that you need them. Instead, desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you as well. Therefore, stop worrying about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
He will never leave you, then he'll go with you
to the end. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there, leave it there. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. If you trust and never doubt, He will surely bring you out. Take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Please be seated. Would you pray with me and for me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts always be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So how many of you are worriers? Yep, see, this is a test because I know some of you well enough now that if you hadn't raised your hand, I could have outed you. I know who the worriers are. All of us, I think, at times are a worrier. And today's scripture is written just for us. The sermon title today is actually a quote from a Bob Marley song. So if you are of a certain age and inclined to listen to reggae occasionally, you know this song. Don't worry about a thing. 'Cause every little thing gonna be all right. The interesting thing is that, you know, Bob Marley was late, very late 20th century, but there was a woman named Julian of Norwich, and in the 1300s, she said the same thing. Maybe not with the same beat or exactly the same words. But Julian of Norwich, who was considered a mystic that had a special and powerful connection to the Spirit of God, she was also a woman theologian and one that was important enough that her work didn't get thrown away. A lot of the women, early Christian women who wrote, we never saw their writings. But Julian of Norwich was held in such esteem that we know who she was and what she believed, and her statement is this: all will be well, and all manner of thing will be well. That was her definition of true faith and true trust in God. To rest in a place that says all will be well, no matter what's going on externally. So they are centuries and they are cultures apart, and yet Bob Marley and Julian of Norwich remind us of the same thing. Remind us that true faith means freedom from anxiety and fear. Jesus, of course, is the in-between here, the bridge here. When he tells us in the scripture today to stop worrying about tomorrow, tomorrow will worry about itself. Desire first and foremost God's kingdom and God's righteousness, and all your other needs will fall into place. So for those of us that are worriers, even if we are just occasional worriers, how much energy does it take to worry? Sometimes a lot. Sometimes a lot, depending on how worked up we get. But what if all of that worrying and anxious energy was applied to actually dealing with whatever we were worried about? Huh. Might be a marvelous thing. But I have a story about a woman who had trouble sleeping for several years because she was so worried about a burglar breaking into her house. So one night, sure enough, a noise is heard downstairs, and her husband goes downstairs to investigate, and there, standing in the living room, is a burglar. The husband sticks out his hand and says, "Pleased to meet you. My wife has been expecting you for years." It takes a lot of energy to worry, energy that could probably be spent in other ways. The Christian writer Ian McLaren says, "What does your anxiety do? It does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow, but it does empty today of its strength. And it does not make you escape evil. It makes you unfit to cope with it when it comes. And a few little quips about worry that I came across. Worry pulls tomorrow's cloud over today's sunshine. And this one you have to follow me on. Get our brains in gear here. It says, worry is wasting today's energy to clutter up tomorrow's opportunities with yesterday's troubles. Gets all mixed up. Or a Swedish proverb that says, worry gives a small thing a big shadow. And the statistics I'm about to quote, I could not verify in any real way, but they felt right to me. It says that an average person's anxiety, the things that you're anxious about, 40%, you're anxious about things that will never happen. 30% of your anxiety is about things in the past that can't be changed. 12% is about criticism for others, most of which is untrue. 10% is anxiety about your health, which only gets worse with stress. And 8% of our worry may be about actual problems that we have to face. Jesus asks us to consider the lilies of the field, to immerse ourselves in the natural world and that recognize God's care and God's power at work in the life cycle of plants and birds and all things. And then he reminds us to focus first on God's kingdom and righteousness, on God's goodness and God's care, and to trust God to give us the strength and the wisdom and the insight we need to face whatever challenge may come our way. Now, we don't often read the 23rd Psalm in a regular worship service, and part of the reason for that is that we read it so often at funerals. But it is a psalm that speaks to us at every point in our lives, and especially at every anxious point in our lives, because it is a psalm of comfort and trust in God's care for us. It's a psalm that reminds us that God always offers us peace and calm in the midst of a world in turmoil. There is always that place of peace and calm in our spirit, no matter what's going on around us. And of course, we use it at funerals for that last line, that ultimate promise that says we will dwell in God's presence forever, in that peace and calm place forever. So I want you to practice finding that place of peace and calm and take a couple of deep breaths. And know that that place is there in spite of what I now need to tell you. So keep breathing. Those of you who have been part of a United Methodist Church for a number of years know that in our system, pastors do not stay put all the time. We are considered itinerant, which means that we move from church to church. And ultimately, we serve at the pleasure of our bishop, who makes our appointment and tries to match the churches with the pastors. And if I might say so, ours has been an excellent match. I've been delighted to be here. But we are appointed 1 year at a time. That's all that we're given. And even that gets interrupted sometimes, as it was when I came here. So I need to announce to you that as of the end of June, I will be moving to Cortez, Colorado, to be the pastor at First United Methodist in Cortez. The first thing I need you to know and to be able to share with anyone who says otherwise, this is not the bishop or the district superintendent or the annual conference forcing me to move. This one's on me, and you can blame me for it. Not them. My district superintendent friends have known for several years that my preference was to eventually end up in a smaller, more rural setting, hopefully in Western Colorado. I told them that actually before I was even appointed here. They didn't listen then. God definitely has a sense of humor. But given that there are only 4 or 5 full-time churches in that part of Colorado, I expected that it would be another 2 or 3 years before I would have the opportunity to move. An unexpected retirement leaves Cortez United Methodist open, and the bishop has offered it to me, and I have accepted. Here's some reasoning. As some of you know, my health has taken a bit of a beating in the last couple of years. Being solo pastor of a 600-member church is not an easy undertaking, and it was a challenge that I joyfully took on as part of our getting our stuff sorted out and being in a healthier place financially. But when I developed shingles last fall, that has been my body's tried and true signal that I'm overextended and exhausting my physical self. And on top of that, I am totally allergic to the air in Salt Lake City. Some of you have watched this develop in my life. I never had asthma till I moved here, and it has become progressively worse with each winter. When I talked to my doctor about the next possibility for the kind of inhaler or something to do about it, she said that you know what the only real cure is. And I said, what? And she said, move. I don't want to be a workaholic anymore. I currently have very minimal time for socializing or being with friends, and when there is time, I often don't have the energy for it, and I would like a better balance of work and personal life. One thing I want you to know is that I came here to Salt Lake. I volunteered for this job. I volunteered to come to Salt Lake, to this church, because I grew up with Marty Zimmerman. And for those of you who were not here when Marty was here, she moved here as pastor and very shortly thereafter was diagnosed with ovarian cancer. And this church saw her through that whole process of dying. I knew Marty. I had followed the events of her illness and death, and I knew that you were hurting, emotionally and spiritually. I followed this church's progress through my friend and mentor, Ron Hodges, when he came in to fill a 4-month interim position. I called him every week just to give him encouragement, and so I saw what was going on. I knew that Ron Hodges and all of you expected that the bishop and the district superintendent would have a pastor ready to step in here in January of 2012, and that was not the case. I can tell you that before I got on board, there were a couple of people that were approached who said no. I knew that you were floundering in worship attendance and in finances, and that really needed a pastor who could help work through those things and provide stability. And I knew that all of my previous church appointments had been to churches with significant conflicts or issues or challenges, and I believed that God had prepared me for this time. I can tell you, Ron Hodges has been bugging me for years to come and serve this church. And each time it opened up, he would say, you need to go there, and I would say, Ron, I'm not ready. This time I was ready. We were ready. And we've moved through a difficult time. It has been 5 years to the day, the 26th of February, since I arrived in Salt Lake City to become your pastor. I can't say I drove to Salt Lake City because I was in the back seat with my leg up because my leg was broken. but I arrived in the hopes and the confidence in God's goodness that we would come through and be stronger for it. And I now believe that I have fulfilled God's purpose and God's calling to be here with you. And I truly believe that you need a new pastor, that your next pastor will be able to move into the future with you and help you cast a vision that goes for 10 and 20 and 30 years down the line. And I know that that is not my gift. So, I am sorry for the unexpected timing. It came earlier than I thought as well. But I'm confident that we can work through this together and enjoy one another for the next 4 months. I definitely will be working with the Staff Parish Relations Committee as they go about working with the district superintendent to identify your new pastor. And what I wrote to Scott Barrett, the chair of that committee this weekend, is this. I said, I will coach the committee through this process, and I will blackball any candidate that does not meet my exacting standards. So they got to get through me to get to you. So there is the clear explanation. I know that you will be very understanding, even as we are all saddened. I also believe with all confidence that when God brings people together in friendship, that friendship can last both the test of time and distance. And I'm counting on that. I also have one very specific request from you. Vanita Conrad, our Christian education director, is in Kent, in Missouri, celebrating her daughter's wedding. It is important to me that she have that time with her family before this comes crashing on her. So please don't email or call or text Vanita until Monday evening. I will call her on Monday and let her know. I'm protecting her in that time. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you that you bring us together in love, that you challenge us to grow, that you have led us, each one of us, to this place and this time. We ask your blessing on the next weeks, that our staff parish committee and the bishop and superintendents will identify for us a marvelous new pastor. We pray for grace in the transition, for the openness to share the sadness, even as we celebrate the achievements and the joy of being friends. God bless each one of us and our church and all of the churches in our connection, knowing that in times of transition and in times of change, you, God, are most powerfully present. In Christ's name, amen. So I told you earlier that the Lenten study was going to be about the Apostles' Creed, and that indeed is the creed I chose for today, so that as you read it together, you can individually be thinking about, well, that's something I have a question about, or I'm not sure about that. And then you can bring those to our study class as we learn together. So would you stand with me as we recite the Apostles' Creed? Let's begin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be.
to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Please be seated.
Lord God of all, accept our offering of money this day, but also the offering of our lives. Help us to live simply, generously, and courageously, that our lives may point to you. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ make us gracious to others. May the love of God our Father make us loving toward all. And may the fellowship and strength of the Holy Spirit fill and empower us until we show in our own lives the very spirit and character of Jesus our Savior. Amen.